canal language means, would you please get out of the way? Because today, we're not in the country, we're right in the heart of London, underneath the busy Edgware Road, and probably up there, the nose to tail in a traffic jam, and here we are, chugging peacefully along on a canal. I'll just make sure there's nothing coming.
Thank you, Douglas. There are actually 4,000 miles of navigable waterway, 2,000 miles of which are actually canals, and I'm sure lots of them are much prettier than this rather damp, dark tunnel. But nowadays you can travel from Surrey all the way up to Yorkshire by canal, but we're not doing that, are we?
No, we're just going to have a look at some of the beautiful London canals that go right through the city, but the only problem is we had to get up very early.
In fact, we had to be on board our boat, the Parry 2, at 7 o'clock in the morning to meet her owner, Hugh McKnight. He's an expert on the canals and has written many books about them.
Pretty. Do you think Hugh's on board?
I can't see him. He's not on.
Give him a yell.
Watch yourself.
Oops, thank you. Hugh? Hugh? Oh, it's
hello. Hello, there he is.
Good morning.
Nice to see you. Jenny, can you start the stove down there for me, please?
Already it's work.
Douglas. And Douglas, come up to this end and help me get the engine going.
Yeah, you get on with the coffee.
Okay.
What I'd like you to do is to start this blow lamp on top of the engine, and that'll get the diesel oil vaporising, and about 7 minutes later it should be ready to fire.
Isn't it dangerous to light this near the engine?
Well, it would be if it was a petrol engine, but this particular type of semi-diesel was invented all about 60 years ago, and it's absolutely safe. Right. It's the only way of getting it going.
Glad to hear it. Let's
see. So just turn that tap on there. Oh, how's it getting on, Jenny?
Hello, I've lit the fire with a certain amount of difficulty, and I thought
you're
going to coffee was
lovely.
Is it,
lot of
is
smoke
it in,
yes, it's
a safe part of the island.
Does it always do that?
Yes, yes, until the wood itself starts to get properly burnt up, and it should settle down, and the only smoke comes out of the chimney on top.
I thought it was just me who'd done that. Tell you what, I've been looking at your book, actually, on inland waterways. That's a really very good book on telling you everything I think one should know. Oh, gosh, I've got coal all over it as well.
Well, that sort of thing happens on canal boats.
Sorry about that. This really is very small, Hugh.
Yes, it is, and this cabin is exactly the same sort of... It's a replica, in fact.
For
it's been going for about... canal boats like this started, in about 1840. Mm. And the canals themselves started a good deal earlier, but people began to live on the boats full-time from about 1840.
Well, all I can see so far is just sort of one long bed, which I suppose could sleep two children.
That's right.
It must have secret drawers and things.
Oh, yes, yes, there are all sorts of secret drawers.
What have you got here?
Well, if we start on this. Now, this looks like a cupboard, right?
Yes.
And we open it up. It is a cupboard, but it's also the living room table.
Wonderful.
So you can eat your meals
off there.
It's
very much like the modern caravan.
Yes, it is. In fact, gypsy caravans look rather like the inside of this boat, don't they?
They do, actually. And all the lace inside and everything.
Yes.
Well, while you get the engine together, I'll just wait until the kettle boils.
Oh, no, you won't. There's one little job I'd like you to do. There's a bit of brass that needs polishing up.
Oh,
so
no.
If you take that drawer full of rags and stuff...
Yes?
And make a start on the chimney outside.
Oh, yeah, you can.
I like my boat to look smart.
All right, you.
How's it doing? Had it 7 minutes?
Yeah.
Right. Well, I've got to kick it from this side like this. And all going well, it should start.
Thanks, fellas!
Sorry!
Oh.
Wonderful.
Coffee time at last. I hope you don't mind me using this, but it's absolutely
no, not at
beautiful.
All. Well, that's what they used to call barge teapots, or Measham teapots, and the canal boat people really used to use them to make their cups of tea or coffee.
Lovely. Hey, by the way, Douglas, where are we?
Well, we're still pretty close to the centre of London, because that's the Westway there, which is only about a mile from the centre. Fairly heavy traffic. Is that about right?
That's right, yes. Well, on the map here, you can see where we started. We started at Maida Hill Tunnel, Little Venice Paddington, just there, and we're travelling westwards, down to join the main line of the Grand Union Canal, and then we'll head down roughly south to meet the Thames at Brentford. The whole thing's about 17 or 18 miles, I suppose.
When the railways came along in this country around about 1830 and spread throughout the country, it was soon realised that they were a lot cheaper and a lot faster than the old transport on the canals. And from that day onward, the days of those grand old boats were numbered. Hey, wait for me!
In the face of stiff competition from the railways, the canals were forced to run down, a process that's continued right up to the present day.
There are still 341 miles of canals still being used for business, aren't there?
Yes, there are, carrying all sorts of cargoes. In fact, at this very moment, there are 30 million tons of cargo being carried on canals in Britain.
What sort of things do they carry?
Oh, just about anything you can think of. Timber, steel, manufactured goods, even lime juice in barrels. That's one quite well-known traffic.
But that still leaves, wait a minute, 341 from 2,000, let's say about 1,600 miles of canals.
Of canals and rivers, yes.
Used for
and
what?
These are used for pleasure cruising, chiefly at the moment. Going on a boat, perhaps hiring a boat for a week or a fortnight, having a super holiday, going through the countryside just as it was, I don't know, 200 years ago. It's hardly changed in that time at all.
And it's good to know. But are we doing anything to conserve the canals that we have and make more canals?
No, we're not making any more canals in this country, sadly. Some of them are being improved and the locks are being made bigger so they can take bigger barges, but there's not very many of them.
Well, this is what they call civilized transport in 1975. Look at them, all buzzing past like ants with hardly a second to spare. They're noisy, they're smelly, and they're certainly very dirty. And there's a tremendous strain on both the driver and the vehicle. But up there, there's a completely different world.
And this, believe it or not, is an aqueduct over the North Circular. And up here it's been so nice and peaceful that we haven't even passed another boat all day. This isn't really a very big aqueduct, is it?
Oh, this is a tiny one.
But it is totally safe.
Well, come to think of it, this one burst in 1962 and flooded the road underneath.
Say no more, Hugh. Douglas! Come on, it's unsafe!
You take that rope.
Okay.
We're now about 15 canal miles away from Little Venice, which we left about 7 o'clock this morning in lovely weather. It's still good weather and we're having a great time. We've got about 4 miles to go to Brentford, that's our destination, and we're at a place called Three Bridges in Southall. It's called Three Bridges because there's an old railway bridge here, there's a bridge created by the canal over the railway, and up there there's a road bridge carrying the road to Southall. And here's my transport coming.
Seeing the canal and the railway together reminded me that the railway companies not only took all the trade from the canals, but also helped in the rundown by buying up great chunks of canal property and allowing them to fall into disuse. Anyway, it was time for me to rejoin the boat and there was lots more work to be done. Once we'd actually got the boat through the top gate, we had to make it secure. Easier said than done, especially as old Caleb, the lock keeper, was keeping a watchful eye on our efforts.
It's quite heavy, isn't it?
Yes.
Hugh wasn't kidding, for that solid oak lock gate must have weighed about 2 tons. But then he gave me a tip. He told me to go around to the other side of the beam and to push it with my bottom. And soon the gate started to move, for in fact, the weight of the gate is balanced by the weight of the beam. Very crafty.
With the top gate firmly shut, I had to open the paddles on the bottom one with a thing called a windlass. Is this the thing, Hugh?
That's right, wind it up.
I'll put some muscle into it.
As the paddle came up, the water started to flow out of the lock, about 56,000 gallons of it, in fact. And then I had to cross back over the lock gate to open up the other paddle. Well, at least I was getting some exercise.
But it's all really quite peaceful going down. It's when you're going up in the lock that the trouble starts and the water rushes in.
Should I just push us away from
it? Yes, give us a shove off from the gate.
As the water emptied out, the Parry 2 settled down into the lock. When the water had leveled, Jenny, with her newfound muscles, opened the bottom gate. Or tried to.
I've got my back in it.
Bit more.
It seemed impossible, but one hefty push and at last the gate started to swing open, slowly. but it did gain weight quite quickly, and in fact, I very nearly fell in.
Wait for the bump. Can you come down and get on the boat, Jenny? Quickly, you'll miss it.
Okay.
Come on, hurry up.
How tall these steps are for? Hold
on.
That is
exhausting. Welcome aboard.
Feeling as if we'd really accomplished something, we were only to be informed by Hugh that there were another 5 locks to go through, making up the Hanwell flight and lowering the canal by 50 feet to bring it to the same level as the Thames. That Hugh's full of little surprises.
We should have been grateful there were only 5, because at Tardybig near Birmingham there's a flight of 30 locks lifting the canal by 217 feet. But 5 or 30, it's all hard work.
So tell me, now the canals are coming up to date, are there any old stories, old frightening stories of the canal?
Well, a few years back I remembered the story from what my mother told me, which I found out was true, about this lady going over the bridge on a white horse, which was originally true. This did actually happen. And my father at the time had a big canal river barge, and my mother had a muscle torn away of her arm with a barge horse, like we've had today, you know. And anyway, this particular night, I came down there. I come back down the bottom end, see that my lock handle was missing off of the gate. I was looking round for it to see where it had gone. And all at once, I see this shadow going over the bridge. And it was actually a lady on a white horse. But more or less, it was a ghost, but you could actually see it going over there.
You could see that it was a real lady on a real horse
was really there, you know. And it actually went over the bridge itself.
Did you hear it?
Well, you could hear the horse actually walking, you know, the footsteps, like, you know. Maybe imagination, but it did actually happen, you know.
Not this horse, of course. This is Patience, and she's one of the last remaining barge horses still working on the canals. We decided to finish off our day by taking it easy, so we turned off the engine and let old Patience do all the work.